Tim Spira is a plant ecologist, native plant gardener, hiker, and professor of botany at Clemson University, where he teaches field botany and plant ecology. Tim received a PhD in botany from the University of California, Berkeley, for which he studied alpine gentians in the White Mountains of California. He's published numerous papers in scientific journals, including a cover article in the journal Nature. Most recently, Tim is the author of the award-winning book, Wildflowers and Plant Communities of the Southern Appalachian Mountains in Piedmont, a naturalist guide to the Carolinas, Virginia, Tennessee, and Georgia, which is available through the University of North Carolina Press. And please enjoy the presentation by Dr. Tim Spira of Clemson University.
Friendly group. Well, I could have brought my golden retriever with me. Anybody know? Anybody enjoy it? Well, it's great to be here. Thanks, Tommy, for that introduction. And you seem like a really nice group, so I'm looking forward to talking with you today about wildflower ecology, a step beyond identification. The joy of wildflower. Here we're in May, and it's a great time to be talking about wildflowers. Wildflowering is exciting because it gets you outdoors, you get exercise, you observe interesting things, and it stimulates the mind. And it's inexpensive, it doesn't impact your pocket. Okay, so what I want to do today is talk more than just about the identification of wildflowers. I want to talk a little bit about their ecology, their natural history. It's fun to be able to walk along a trail and pick out the different wildflowers and know their names. But you can add another layer of fun by learning about their ecology. And that's what I want to do today. And so let's start off looking out west to the Cascades and Sierra Nevada, these wonderful wildflower displays. And then the hill country of Texas. And I'm not sure the colors are quite right here, so some of these colors are not quite true, but I think you get the idea. And then closer home in the Blue Ridge Mountains, Ridge Cove Forest, and other such habitats are wonderful, incredibly diverse mountain flora. Okay, but we've all enjoyed wildflowers. We all enjoy looking at them, but if you take the time to think about why we have such showy, beautiful flowers, and why there's so many varieties of flowers. Like flowers are so different in color and shape and fragrance, and how they're arranged on the plant. And that's one of the things that I want to talk about today. We know that horticulturalists can produce tremendous diversity in flowers, such as these different flower color notes of mums at the Biltmore House Gardens in Nashville. But what I'd like to do is talk about the variation that we see in the natural world. And why so many flowers? Why do they look so different? Why do different species have different looking flowers? And when I first introduced that question in the talk, a woman said, oh, it's a gift. And certainly that's one perspective. What I'd like to do today is to give a biological explanation for that diversity, how biologists interpret why we have this diversity. Well, a key driver for the diversity of flowers that we have is pollinator diversity. The diversity of pollinators, at least in part, is driving the diversity of flowers that we have today. That is, flowers are adapted to different types of pollinators. Okay? And before we get into the details on that, I want to just go over a few pollination basics here. And first, with the definition of what pollination is, it's the transfer of pollen from the anthers. I guess I can use this laser pointer here. From the anthers, the little pollen sacs, to the stigma, this part of the flower here. And pollination can be self-pollination. Pollinations within a flower, or between flowers on the same plant, or can involve cross-pollination, that is, pollination between different plants. In general, cross-pollination is better than self-pollination from a plant perspective, and we'll talk a little bit about why that's the case toward the end of the talk. Many plants have large, showy, fragrant, colorful flowers, and their function is to attract pollinators, and in return, the flowers are offering a food reward, which many of you are familiar with, nectar and or pollen. So what we have is typically a mutualism between the plant and its pollinators. The plant is providing food, and in turn, the pollinators typically pollinate the flowers. So a question that arises, do animals intentionally pollinate flowers? Well, it turns out there's no altruism here. They're going about their business collecting nectar or pollen. And here's a bumblebee with its mouth parts probing the flower for nectar. And as it's scrambling around the flower looking, trying to get to where the nectar is produced, or maybe where the pollen is produced, it then inadvertently gets pollen deposited on its body surface, some of which then may later be transferred to a stigma. So this process of pollination, which is mandatory for flowers to mature fruits, is totally an accidental process. Here's a bee coming into a hibiscus flower, and here are the stigmas of the flower, and the bee is brushing against the stigmas inadvertently, accidentally, as it's trying to get to the bottom of the flower to get to the nectar. I wonder, could we turn off these? I think you might see the slides a little bit. So you can see this bumblebee has lots of pollen on its body surface, and some of that pollen, I think that's a little better, isn't
it? Yes,
a little bit. Okay. Yeah, so the bumblebee then may transfer pollen onto the stigma, resulting in pollination. Now, if you observe nature, you often see things on flowers. Lots of different insects. Are they pollinators? Well, they may or may not be. This ladybug beetle probably isn't. This grasshopper almost certainly isn't. So just because something is visiting a flower doesn't mean it's a pollinator. And not all pollinators are equal. Some are more efficient, more effective than others. Here's an example of that. Here's a flower, two flowers of the same type. This is a flower that's adapted to hummingbirds as pollinators. And as the hummingbird visits the flower, probes the flower for nectar, it gets zapped on the head by the exerted anthers and stigmas. This plant actually has blue pollen, and the hummingbirds, you can actually see a blue on the top of their head, and the pollen is deposited. This large bee over here, though, isn't a good fit for the flower. Its body size, its shape, is not appropriate for pollination to occur. So this flower, over time, has become adapted to hummingbirds as pollinators. So we've got flowers of different species adapting to different kinds of pollinators, hummingbirds, butterflies, bees, moths, flies, beetles, bats, in some cases small mammals. So let's talk a little bit about some of the characteristics associated with different pollinators. These are generalities. These aren't absolutes, but these are trends. Butterfly flowers are typically red, yellow, orange, have a sweet odor, produce nectar. That's what the butterflies get as a food reward, nectar. They don't collect pollen. And the flowers are often tubular. I'm going to go through and list the characteristics for about six different pollinator types. This can be useful for those of you who like to hike, or wander around in your backyard. You can look at flowers in nature and make predictions as to what the pollinator type might be based on the flower's characteristics. So let's talk a little bit about moth-pollinated flowers. They're typically white or pale colored. Why is that? Well, moths are most active in the evening or at night. At night, white or dull-colored flowers tend to stand out more. But even more important than the color of moth-pollinated plants is the fragrance. And moth-pollinated flowers typically have a strong, sweet odor. And that fragrance is most intense in the evening or at night. So if you're walking in the evening, may pick up the scent of a pollinating species that you wouldn't pick up earlier in the day. Nectar is the food reward, so moth pollinating flowers tend to produce abundant nectar. And there's sort of a co-evolution that's going on here between moths and flowers typically. In terms of moth pollinating flowers, typically have a very long, corolla tube, but the flower tube is very long. The mouth pods of the moth are also very long. Look at here. The moth is hovering in front of the flower. Look at the mouth pods going all the way down to here and then expand down to the ear. It's pretty amazing. Bees as pollinators. Of course, when you say bees, a lot of people think of this bee, the honeybee, Apis mellifera, which isn't even native to North America. That's an introduced bee, introduced by Europeans. But fortunately for native plants, worldwide there are about 20,000 different species of bees. 20,000 different species of bees. Can you hear me okay? Talk a little louder. Okay, so there are about 20,000 different species of bees. Okay. And bees are the most important pollinator group. Bees pollinate more flowers than any other kind of pollinator. So, and bees and flowers have a long history. About the time that the angiosperms, the flowering plants, came on the scene about 120 million years ago, and then underwent incredibly rapid speciation. That's about the time that bees were undergoing speciation too. There's a long co-evolutionary history between bees and flowers. And what's driving that is the sole larval food source for bees is pollen. That's what bee larvae eat, is pollen. So bees are going to flowers to collect nectar as an energy source and pollen as a larval food source. Honeybees have their back leg, their tibia on their back leg is widened, and they pack pollen onto that leg, bring it back to the heart. So bee pollinated flowers are typically yellow or blue. They have a sweet fragrance. They open during the day. They produce nectar and pollen. And flowers that are pollinated by bees often look different to bees than they look to you or I. Here's a marigold flower. How it looks to us. Bees' visual spectrum is different. They can perceive UV light. So this is what this flower looks like to a bee. And this photograph was taken with a UV filter. And so, the variation in flowers, because of the way flowers reflect or absorb UV light, that adds some color diversity that we don't perceive, but can be very important, as I'll talk about shortly. Hummingbird pollinating flowers often are red, and you know that hummingbird feeders, they always have some red in there. If you're hiking in the mountains of Colorado in the middle of summer, and you've got something red on you, hummingbirds can check it out. They tend to associate the color red with a potential food source. They do visit flowers of other colors too. They have long tubular corollas. In part, by having a long tubular corolla, that excludes many other things from getting access to the nectar. Typically, just things with long mouth parts can get access to that nectar, so that can benefit the plant, and then it's not wasting the nectar on non-pollinators. But also, hummingbirds have high energy demands. They're larger in size, and also the way they visit the flower, they don't land on the flower, they hover in front of the flower, as you see here. And that takes a lot of energy. They consume a lot of calories by hovering in front of flowers as they get nectar. So the flowers, in order to attract and maintain hummingbirds as pollinators, the plant has to produce abundant nectar. Interestingly, the nectar is quite dilute, has a low sugar concentration. Remember those Heinz ketchup commercials where they brag about how their ketchup is thick and it flows slowly? Well, if the nectar was real thick with sugar, it was highly concentrated, the nectar in a hummingbird's tongue, they have a grooved tongue. And apparently the nectar flows up the tongue in part via capillary action. So if it's too concentrated, the hummingbird's going to be hovering there forever and probably expending more calories than it's getting from the nectar. So the flowers are attractive in the sense of having a low nectar sugar concentration. Hummingbirds don't have a well-developed sense of smell. So flowers adapted to hummingbirds typically aren't fragrant. They're not wasting energy producing a fragrance. Over here is a hummingbird visiting a flower here. Look at the yellow on the bird's head. That's pollen. Bats, as pollinators. We don't have any bat pollinated species here in the southeast. There are some in the southwestern deserts. But bat pollination is most common in the tropics. Bat pollinated flowers, as you'd expect, they open at night and bats are actively flying. The flowers are white or dull colored. Again, they stand out in the night sky, in the dark sky. And the flowers are very fragrant. Bats use odor more than sight to locate their flowers. So going back to this photo here, this wonderful desert scene in the southwest here, all these different flowers, all these different colors, they're there because they're trying to attract pollinators with their showy flowers, and those flowers may be adapted to different pollinator types, but there's more to the story. And this is a little bit more subtle here. There's a foraging behavior that's particularly common in bees, but also exhibited to some extent by other pollinator types, called flower constancy. And that is, bees, for example, they tend to focus on a particular plant species, at least on single foraging bouts or for short periods of time. And the benefit from the pollinator perspective of doing that is that there's a learning curve involved as to where the nectar is located within the flower and how to go about getting it. So if a bee would just randomly sort of visit every which flower that might be open in a meadow or forest, it would be very efficient at harvesting nectar and or pollen. So by focusing on the flowers of one type, at least for short periods of time, that is, they recognize a plant that has a good nectar or pollen source, and they tend to focus on it, visit flowers of that type, go from plant to plant of the same species, that increases their foraging efficiency. They expend less energy and get more resources in return. So that's the payoff for the pollinator via flower constancy. How does that benefit the plant? How does flower constancy benefit the plant? Well, let's look at this slide here. And this shows about a half a dozen different plants that flower in the spring, from hepaticas to trout lilies to Virginia bluebells. These flowers are actually blue. To yellow jessamine, the state flower of South Carolina. All these flowers are open, can be open simultaneously in the spring, and if this bee were to go from flower to flower of all these different species just randomly, that would help the plant. Because if you're a trout lily, for pollination to occur in trout lily, you need pollen from other trout lily flowers. Hepatica pollen doesn't do trout lily any good. Yellow jessamine pollen doesn't do Virginia bluebell flowers any good. So you get the idea of flower constancy that increases the likelihood of compatible, the right pollen landing on a particular flower. It's like a lock and key mechanism. You need a particular key to open a lock. You need the pollen of the same species to pollinate a flower for that flower to mature a fruit. So, how does this get back to the question of why do we have this incredible diversity of flowers, all that variety and joy? The answer, in part, is it pays to be different. In order for flower constancy to work, the bee has to be able to recognize flowers. flowers that are a good food source and distinguish the flowers of that species from other species' flowers. So that's selective. That's been another factor, another driving force, selecting for the variation that we have in nature in terms of flower color, shape, order, fragrance, when the flower is open, etc., etc., etc.
Could I ask a question?
Sure.
So what I understand is you're saying because there's a learning curve for the pollinators, that by the flowers sort of coming out at one time, they tend to go to the ones that they've learned how to, and then they basically pollinate the same flowers.
They'll go, okay, they'll locate a plant that is a good nectar source, and they'll stay on the plant. That, if there are a sufficient number of flowers, and they remain open for X number of days, they'll tend to hone in on that. And particularly if we're talking about, remember, we've got all these different kinds of bee species. Honeybees are a little different, they're social, and there are a lot of other things going on there. But typical native bee, they're going to be focused on a flower that's a good nectar source. Now, they'll periodically check out other flowers. Like if you watch bumblebees, they may be focusing primarily on one plant species, but they'll periodically check out others just to see if there's a plant that may on the other side of the plant.
Right.
Okay. Now, but you know, plants come into flower. You know, a species in the spring may be in flower for 2 weeks and then it's gone, and something else. Also, you have flowers that are producing nectar at different times of the day. So in the morning, you may be honing in on one species, and then at noon, maypop flowers, passion vine flowers, those flowers open up about noon or 1 o'clock. So bumblebees and carpenters shift to them. Later in the afternoon, maybe something else. So that's what I'm saying on particular foraging bouts for short periods of time, they tend to focus on the flower. It's not absolute, you know, there's some gray area in there, but by having this tendency, that increases the likelihood of successful pollination.
One quick question. So the only benefit of carpenter bees is they are pollinators.
That's right. The fact that they drill holes in your lawn is not but they do function as pollinators. Yeah. The state flower, I haven't mentioned this, yellow jessamine also occurs in North Carolina, but yellow jessamine is pollinated mainly by carpenter bees. By yellow jessamine, the state flower is
yellow jasmine.
This is this plant that you'll see in the barns. It's pollinated mainly by carpenter bees. Okay, now, of course, not all plants have large, showy, colorful, nectar-rich flowers. Some plants have flowers that look like this, and this is a chickweed, like the chickweed you have in your lawn. Very small and conspicuous flowers. This is a self-pollinating plant. There's some advantages to being self-pollinating, in that self-pollinating plants have small flowers. They don't need to produce large, showy flowers. They're selfing, they're selfers, so they don't need to attract pollinators, so they don't have to expend energy on large, showy petals. They don't have to produce any nectar, and they can minimize their pollen production because they do it automatically by the anthers and stigmas leaving in close proximity. They expend less energy. Also, they have higher fruit set and seed set. You know, in nature, typically, you have many more flowers than fruits. Not all flowers mature fruits. Selfers, though, have a much higher proportion of the flowers maturing fruit. So why don't all plants have showing, you know, boring flowers like this? Less energy, more efficient fruit and seed production. Anybody know the answer?
Bees eat the food.
Bees eat the food. Okay, well, are the plants being altruistic then? Okay, here's the deal. There's a cost to this. Remember I said cross-pollination is often better than self-pollination. There's several things going on there. One is something called a reduction in vigor. The fancy name is inbreeding depression. You know, in human societies across the world, you don't marry cousins, you don't marry relatives because of genetic problems. And plants the same. If you have selfing, that's extreme inbreeding, that is a genetic cost to that. Makes you other things go on, so like when you have cross pollination, you have combining genes from different individuals. Thirdly, if you're mixing genes, mixing cross pollination,
gene pool,
that
increases resistance to disease population, and it may increase susceptibility to a range of microbiota in the species that may be able to offer.
What about,
so there's some real benefits associated with pollination change and mixing climate change, just the reacts with plants and other organisms that have increased costs associated with seed production and increased risk of unsuccessful fruit and seed sale. Question?
Well, considering the negative aspects of self-pollination, why would plants, I understand that it's more efficient in the sense you don't have to have a pollinator coming.
That's the other feature, right?
But it would seem that the risks would outweigh the benefit, and that these plants would go extinct fairly quickly in geologic time.
Well, there's some other things. You know how we talked about the reduction in vigor, the green impression right. idea? What self-pollinating plants do, well, the reason for the reduction in vigor, typically, or inbreeding depression, is because you have harmful recessive alleles. It increases when you have selfing or mating between relatives, there's a higher probability of getting pairs of harmful recessive alleles. These selfers, over time, tend to purge the population of those harmful recessive alleles.
Oh.
So they don't have the genetic variability typically in an outcross over the out, but they don't suffer the inbreeding depression to the extent that a plant that is typically cross-pollinating in the wood. Okay? So there's some complications here. There are some plants that are selfies that are extremely successful. Let me give you an example of a plant that I think you'd agree is very successful. How about the common dandelion? Very successful plant. Worldwide, every continent but Antarctica, pretty widespread plant in disturbed areas, and it's successful. So, here, yes?
Don't they have to cross-pollinate at some point? Or they would be a single linear species, each one would be.
Well, there's some plants that are intermediate. It's not like you just have outcrossers and selfers. There are plants that are in between that have mechanisms to promote outcrossing. You've got bloodroot, you know bloodroot, they're a wonderful spring wildflower. When the flowers open up, the anthers and stigmas are spatially separated and cross-pollination is possible and encouraged. But if cross-pollination fails to occur as the flower ages, the anthers and stigmas come together and self-pollinate. So better to plant some seeds than no seeds. So you've got a lot of plants that some proportion of their seeds are outcrossed and some are selfers. Yeah.
Unless it's a low-growing flowers or plants, the self-pollinators?
It can vary. We're talking about woodland wildflowers. We've got some woodland wildflowers that are very showy. I mean, trout lilies, blood worms, wild ginger, and so on. So that varies. So chickweed is a low-growing plant along the that. So there's some interesting things going on. We can talk all day about this topic. There's a lot of things going on here. But let me move on here because there's some other things we want to talk about. So I do want to then, in terms of benefits here, there are many, many, many plants that are like this. There are also some that are like this. The fact that there are many, many, many plants that are like this would suggest that the benefits outweigh the cost. Okay, so again, flowers, if everything goes right, if pollination occurs, if resources are available, if you don't have a late frost, if you don't have insect damage, these flowers such as these passion vine flowers, which are fruits. Fruits come from flowers. So the second part of the talk really has to do with fruits. And like flowers, fruits are incredibly variable in size, shape, color, taste, fragrance, and other features. And the main function of fruits is to facilitate dispersal. That's the function of fruits, is to promote successful dispersal, the dispersal of seeds. So what are the benefits of seed dispersal? Obviously, that's important, that plants are producing these fruits that promote dispersal. But one is, if all of the seeds that a plant produces drop below the parent plant,
you can have enormous sibling competition, right? Sibling competition. You've got thousands seedlings here of impatience, jewelry, relatively quickly to survive. Also, if the seeds are dropped below the parent plant, those offspring have to compete with the parent plant, which is they're not going to be able to compete very good with a larger established plant. Also, if you've got lots of seeds dropped below the parent plant, seed predation tends to be high. There are things that feed specifically on seed. So by spraying the seeds out, it reduces seed predation risk. But also, what's a favorable habitat today may not be a favorable habitat tomorrow, meaning next year or 3 years down the road. So it's important for plants to disperse their seeds widely. So let's talk briefly about some of the mechanisms of dispersal. You're probably familiar with some of these, but ballistic dispersal. Some plants go ballistic, right? And jewelry is a classic example. You're familiar with this. It's sometimes called touching knot. This is one of our two native jewelries. If you touch a fruit like this, this is a ripe fruit. If you touch it, it's under high turbo pressure. It does this, whereby the seeds are flung away from the parent plant, 10 feet away, in some cases 20 feet, even 30 feet. Violets, witch hazel, jewelry, wood sorrel, mountain wood sorrel, a number of our plants exhibit ballistic dispersal. Wind dispersed seeds, we're all familiar with wind dispersed seeds. Seeds that are tiny, like orchids. Orchid seeds are the size of ducks, and they can get up in air currents and be dispersed from one continent to another. During bird kills. We've got a lot of orchids that grow in South Florida. They're tropical orchids, long distance dispersal. Plume seeds, like milkweeds, or dandelions with their parachute-like aspect. And of course, maples with their wing seeds. All of these structures reduce the rate of fall. They keep the seed up in the air for a longer period, thereby increasing the chance of the seeds to be dispersed a greater distance. I won't talk about water dispersal, but I will talk about you. We do this, right? We all do this. Don't like it, but we do it. And so we do this, but keep in mind, of course, that animals do this too, brushing against fruits that have barbs, bristles, or hooks. Can be a very effective way. You know, when Europeans colonized North America, they often had sheep on board. Sheep roll around in grass, get seeds in their fur. Intercontinental dispersal by sheep. And a lot of those weed species came in and become exotic invasives from early on. Dispersal by ants, some of you probably know about that. Tim Lee is probably going to talk about that when he talks about plant-animal interactions. Lots of our woodland herbaceous plants have ant-dispersed seeds, including, just to name a few, bloodwood, trilliums, or violets. But many, many, many flowering plants have fleshy fruits that attract frugivores. And frugivores, this name here is just a fancy name for animals that feed on fruits. And here again, we have a mutualism, just like in the plant pollinator story. The animal is consuming the fruit, and as such, consumes the pulp, but the seeds within typically pass through the animal's gut. And the seeds somehow survive that journey through the gut, and are dispersed in the animal's droplet. We'll talk more about that shortly. But we've got this tremendous diversity in fruits. These are some of our native species here. Plants have some pretty exciting ways to attract frugivores. Here's Indian cucumber roots. Do some of you know this plant? Have you noticed how as the flowers hang down below the upper leaves, and then as the fruits are developing, the flowers come upright, and they're perched above this world of leaves, and the base of the leaves turn scarlet color, and the fruits ripen into a dark blue, blackish color. And those contrasting colors really stand out to birds, which disperse the fruits. Okay. Birds have excellent visual acuity. You can recognize and distinguish fruits of different species. Do you recognize this plant here?
Dalsa.
Dalsa, you got it. Here it is.
Okay, so fleshy fruit and species, the fruit is functioning as both the attractant and the reward. And these are pop-up fruits, which you may have recognized here. So how did these seeds survive? How did the ingested seed survive? A bird or mammal feeding on a fruit, how is the seed going to survive? Well, there's several things, several possibilities. In some cases, birds that feed on berry-like fruits often will regurgitate the seed, sort of like us spitting out the seeds of a watermelon. Okay? In other cases, the seed passes through the gut and survives the journey. How does it do that? One way is that quite a number of our fleshy-fruited species have a chemical within the fruit that quickens the digestive process. It's called the cathartic chemical. It causes a bowel movement. So the seed doesn't remain in that acid bath for as long as a period. And then thirdly, the seeds associated with these fleshy fruits are typically have a thick, strong seed coat. So it's resistant to the acids in the gut. In fact, what those acids do is they often will weaken the seed coat, such that when the seed then passes through, it's actually more germinable. Can actually enhance the germinability or quicken the germination of the seeds because the seed coat has been thinned, so that such that the seed then is more likely to be able to imbibe water, take up water, and germinate. And of course, associated with the dropping is the plant gets a little added value here, right? The nutrients associated with the dropping provide nutrients for the seedling. Do also note that when we have fruits like this persimmon here, you don't want to get a persimmon that's not ripe, right? Have any of you ever been to a persimmon? Not a fun experience. It's incredibly pungent. You'll remember that. Well, birds and mammals quickly learn that too. And notice how the color change in fruits, unripe fruits are typically green, and then as they ripen, they undergo this the color change here, right? So birds and mammals typically associate, they recognize when the fruit is ripe because that's when it's tasty, sugary, or the fats are present. Whereas unripe fruits have bitter compounds, the fruit is often hard. So they're deterrents in the fruit to prevent animals from feeding on the fruit prematurely. That would be very damaging to the plant because the seeds are not ripe yet, they'd be killed. Okay? So associated with fruit ripening is a color change, often an odor change, some chemical changes, which function as cues to these fruit rewards. Among mammals, lots and lots of different mammals feed on fruits, all of these guys do, and others as well, feed on fruits and pass the seeds in their droppings. And mammals typically prefer sweet fruits, and the fruits are often low to the ground, or they drop to the ground. Maybe a taller bush or even tree, and when ripe, if the fruit drops to the ground, that's when they typically feed on it. But of course, the most important disperser really are the birds. Birds are particularly good at removing a high proportion of fruits from plants. So a plant that has hundreds, if not thousands, of fruits, it's beneficial if a very high proportion of them are taken, removed, dispersed away from the parent plant. And birds are often very good at doing that. Also, birds move around a lot, so there's the potential for the birds to be dispersed longer distance or wider, more widespread. And then also, as the seeds pass through the bird's gut, they do tend to be scarified, which aids germination. Okay, in the summertime, many of our fleshy food species in the summer tend to be high in sugars and low in fats. And just a few familiar examples, blueberries, blackberries, and something called huckleberry exhibit that. These are fruits high in sugars and low in fats. But when we get into fall, we have a number of fleshy-fruited species that are described as fall high quality fruiting species. These are species that are high, the fruits are high in fats and low in sugars. Things like spice fruit, sassafras, flowering dogwood, Virginia creeper are high fat, low sugar fruits. So what is it about high fat fruits?
Higher
calories per gram. Lots of calories. So if you're a fall migrant, for example, and you've got a small gut, and you're going to fly long distances, including over the Gulf, Florida, to Mexico, Central America, these birds prefer these high-fat fruits, these high-energy fruits. So they tend to be taken quickly. It's hard to get a photograph of sassafras and fruit because they go so quickly, to take it so quickly. Ditto for spice fruits.
Would they also survive lower temperatures? Would that be better?
These fruits here survive lower temperatures? I don't know. They might. I don't know about that. I do know that the high-fat fruits tend to break down. They chemically degrade more quickly. They don't last as long on the plant. They're shorter-lived than high-sugar fruits. Of course, they cost the plant more, too, to produce. So there's an increased energetic cost for the plant, but there's potentially a higher return in the sense of a higher proportion of the fruits being taken that is being dispersed. Now, we also have in the fall a number of fall low-quality fruiting species. And these are fruits that are low in fats and low in sugar, so they're not preferred. These are the fruits that tend to persist for a long time. So birds and mammals can recognize different fruits, distinguish different fruits, and they have preferences. And these kinds of things like greenbriars, winter berry, and on a forest floor, things like partridge berry. If you're hiking, you know partridge berry. Those red fruits you can find right now in the spring. They were produced last year. They're still there. They haven't been taken. They're low in fats, low in sugars. Questions?
I've heard that, this is a little aside, that greenbriars are greens for deer in the winter, that they're eaten by deer.
I think they are, yeah.
I see. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so partridge berry. Look at the interesting thing about partridge berry. It takes two flowers to mature one of these fruits. The two flowers are fused at the base. Have you ever noticed that? Take a look at partridge berry sometimes. It's in flower about now, this time of year. There are two flowers, they're fused at the base, and the two of them together mature one of these red fruits, and those low sugar, low fat fruits, they persist. Winter green, this is called theria here, its fruits tend to persist for a long time. Eventually, these low quality fruits are taken, but as I say, they often persist through winter, and as such, they're some of our favorite landscape fruits. American holly is such a favorite because it has evergreen foliage and these red berries that persist so long on the plant through winter. Through the most cloudy, kind of gloomy short days are kind of brightened up for us humans by having these red berries in the short. Winter berry is another kind of holly, but it drops its leaves, but those red berries really stand out in the winter. Eventually they are taken, often by flocking birds.
What's the payoff for the plant to have a fruit that is not as easily dispersed as a plant that is if you propagate?
Yes, well, there's a good question. Less energy involved in producing those fruits, less energy expended. You know, plants, and a lot of people don't think about this, but you know, plants like animals have limited resources, and it's important how they partition those resources. And so they have a limited amount of resources for reproduction. And so these plants then are expending less energy per fruit by not having as many sugars or fats in them. Now, so these fruits then persist well into winter, oftentimes practically in the spring. Often they're eventually taken by flocking birds. Have you seen that? You may have an American holly in your yard that is full of berries one day, and you come out, well, you often notice the flock feeding on them, and within a day or two, all those fruits have been gleaned from the tree. So eventually, a significant number of the fruits typically are dispersed. They're dispersed at the time of year when there are fewer other foods available for them. So they eventually get to these fruits when there's not much else to eat.
Isn't a holly also a good source of pollen?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good nectar plant. You've got a male. Hollies, all of our hollies are dioecious, so they're separate male and female trees. And I've got one in my yard, and it's just this time of year when it's in full flowers, attracting all kinds of insects. The nectar is good nectar plant, good pollen. The flowers are small, but there's an enormous number of them, so it attracts a lot of insects. So things like the American robins and mockingbirds and what do you see? Cedar waxwings. So a couple of take home messages. First, getting back to the flowers here, we've got an enormous number of flowers that we enjoy. And the reason why we have those flowers to enjoy in part is because of adaptations to different pollinator types and the benefits of looking different. Individual species having a distinct flower to promote flower constancy, as we discussed. And then with regard to fruits, we've got this tremendous variation in fruits. And again, we have a mutualism going on where the animal is getting food and the plant is getting its seeds dispersed. Yeah, so we've talked about plant-pollinator, plant-fruit-borne interactions as being mutualisms. The pollinators benefiting the plant, the birds and mammals are benefiting the plant as well, typically. What about humans? We certainly benefit from plants, native plants and natural habitats. What are we getting in return? Are we mutualists? Are we kind of just taking advantage of the plants? And I think that's where conservation groups such as yours are so important, because you folks are the ones that are going to help maintain native plants and natural habitats in perpetuity for future generations to enjoy. And that's really important. Thank you.